So we next move to the main event of this first part of the morning, which is the Schumpeter lecture given by Jaume Ventura. So I'm very grateful to Jaume for joining us. Jaume is the director of CREI. He's a professor at the University of Pompeu Fabra, GSE research professor, and he directs the Master in International Trade, Finance and Development at GSE. Before joining CREI, Jaume was tenured at MIT, and he also taught at Chicago, LBS, and INSEAD. He's been editor of the Economic Journal and associate editor of the QJE, the GIA, and the Review of Economics and Statistics. And he has received two ERC advanced grants, one for his research on asset bubbles and another one more recently on globalization and political structure, which I believe is linked to the topic of what he'll talk about today. So Jaume's research is at the intersection of macroeconomics and international economics. He has made path-breaking contributions on the macroeconomics of bubbles, how incorporating rational bubbles into macro models can account for important macroeconomic phenomena. And in his work with Alberto Martin, he basically builds on the assumption that asset prices are not only driven by fundamentals, but also by bubbles that respond to shifts in market psychology. But these bubbles are consistent with individual rationality, as shifts in market psychology can be incorporated into standard macro models that rely on rational expectations. Jaume has also worked on growth and interdependence, on how international trade affects the rates of return to capital and the world's income distribution, and on the effects of globalization on risk sharing and welfare. So we may be very familiar with his CV, but there's something that maybe we don't know as outsiders, and that's really how, in his research style, Jaume has almost an obsession with model elegance and simplicity. So I got this hint from one of his co-authors, who told me that Jaume can easily have a paper ready and suddenly think of a slightly different modeling assumption and be perfectly happy to rewrite the whole thing over and over. And this obviously is reflected in the end result, because if you look at his papers, they're really a pleasure to read, very elegant and very insightful. He's also a pleasure to listen to, and I have some personal experience on that, because the first time I met Jaume, it was in the fall of 1994 when I started my PhD at Harvard. He was the TA for the macro class. And one thing I distinctly remember is that I had trouble distinguishing between the main instructors and the TA. So this class was taught by Greg Mankiw, John Campbell, Robert Barra, I mean, Alberto Lesina. They were really top macroeconomists. And when we went in the sessions with Jaume, he looked absolutely in command, exactly the same way as these big shots were. So I would say he served as a role model for us at that time, not in the sense that I ended up doing macro, but in the sense that when I thought about me teaching, I always, you know, was inspired by how he did. And looking at his CV, I noticed that he got the best teacher award at MIT more than once. So we were not the only one to think of him this way. So given what I told you about his elegance in modeling and his clarity in explanation, I think we can have great expectations for the lecture that he's going to deliver today. Thank you, Jaume.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Liana. Thank you very much. Now you made it difficult for me. It's going to be complicated, but as Eliana was saying, most of my work has been in macro, pure macro. A couple of years ago, I started to work on topics of political economy and government, and I was, brave or enough to come and to talk to you about this topic, a topic that I'm just learning about, okay? But I'm going to share with you what I am learning. And I think that what I am learning is quite interesting, at least to me, and I hope that we can share that a little bit all together. The topic I will talk about today is about the costs and the benefits of centralizing or decentralizing political decisions. Okay, should we make political decisions at what level of government? This is a very timely question. I mean, all of you, all of us, follow the construction of the European project. When you look at the European project, despite recent setbacks like Brexit, we realize that it's moving forward. The European institutions have more power now than they had ever had before. This power is still much less, for example, than the power of the US federal government. And the questions that arise is, should the European Union's powers grow up to the US federal government or not? They should stop short of that. Why? Who should make the decisions, the specific decisions? Should it be the European Union? Should it be the member states? Which ones are appropriate for the European Union? Which ones are appropriate for the European states? If you look at the history of Europe also, you see that the history of Europe basically is a history of empire building and breakup. And this is the old traditional way of centralizing and decentralizing. Okay, the construction of empires and the destruction of empires. Fortunately, war is no longer in Europe, or at least we perceive it this way, is no longer in Europe a way to change political structure. But you can see also in many countries, like for example the UK, Belgium, and Spain, that there are forces or there are tensions that want to change borders somehow. And certainly this is a struggle for political power. What sort of decisions should be taken by the central governments? What sort of decisions should be taken by the regional governments? These are questions that are quite important, and I want to think a little bit about them. I'm not going to have a solution. I'm not going to give you like a simple, easy answer or quick fix to all these problems. That's not the goal here. If that were the goal, I would not be here because I'm not capable of doing that. But what I'm going to try to do over the next hour is to share you some methodological or ideas on how should we approach this topic. How should we think about it? Okay, and I'm going to be very precise. I'm going to be very clear, hopefully, as Eliana was saying. Now I feel terrible. I feel I have to make sure I am as clear as possible. But I'm going to try to, I'm going to try to be as clear as possible in trying to go to the basics and try to think about this problem. And for doing that, as always, to make progress, one has to be narrow. One has to say exactly what's the problem we're dealing with, to be concrete, and use that to at least get an answer in that more narrow or concrete situation. So let me tell you exactly what I'm planning to do, okay? So I'm going to talk about the classic assignment problem. And for those of you that are not in the area, for example, myself a few years ago, let me explain you a little bit exactly what I mean. I'm going to consider a world or a situation where there are many regions. So I'm going to consider a situation where there are many regions. These regions have, each of them, their own regional government. But on top of that, they share a central or union government. Okay? So it's a situation, like a situation, for example, that you can think of it as the case of the European Union and the member states. Each member state has its own government, obviously, but on top of that, there are some Union European Parliament and Council and some institutions or government at the Union level. You can also zoom down and, for example, think of it as a model for Germany. Okay? You have a German federal government and you have the Länder as well, with their own governments and so on. Okay? So that's going to be the situation that we have. There are many political decisions that these governments have to make. These governments might decide, we want to build a new infrastructure, a bridge. Yeah? There's a region, we do a bridge, we do a highway. We can talk about public health coverage. Should certain particular interventions or rules certain particular type of illnesses or type of things you covered or not, who is covered by public health, or to pensions. How generous are we with the pensions? Who is covered? What is the size of these pensions? We have to decide on banking regulation. Do we want to put a tax on banks or don't put a tax on banks? Do we want to put restrictions on their behavior or not? Schools. Do we want to put restrictions on schools, on what they teach or not, or how do we do school curricula and so on? These are all sets of decisions or projects, I'm going to call them projects, in the sense that we can implement them or we cannot implement them. And the question that is going to be the key issue here is that these projects or these decisions in a world that is interdependent, in a world that is globalized, as the one that we live, provide local benefits to the region that is implementing that project, whatever it might be, but it also creates externalities to all the other regions in the Union. You're with me? That's the key issue. It's going to be, if a region makes a decision, it's going to make that decision, it's going to have some local benefits, but it's going to have also effects on the other regions. And the question is, given that that's the case, given that projects affect everyone in the Union, what level of government should decide whether these projects are implemented or discarded? That's the key question. So what is the level of government? How do we decide about this? That's the simple question that we're going to deal with. It's a simple but important question. Today, I'm not going to talk about whether we want to be part of the Union or not. Today, I'm not going to talk about whether we should have a union or not. So today, I'm not going to talk about country formation, secession, union formation, and all of that. If you are interested, still the first stop is the Lesina Spoloore book of 2003, an excellent first starting point to think about issues of country formation and union formation. And if you want to have a bias reference, I just wrote a paper a little while ago with my colleagues Gino Gancia and Giacomo Ponzetto on how countries break up or not, how unions are formed, and all of that. But today I'm not going to talk about that. There's a union, and there's a central government or union government, and there are the regional governments. And the only question we're going to be addressing is who should decide what. Okay? That's the key question that we're going to go today. Now, obviously, there's a long tradition of trying to answer this question. Let me start by just pointing out that there's a traditional or public finance approach to this question, which is mostly linked to the name of William Oates. This tradition basically makes the following assumption. It assumes that governments are benevolent. That's very macro style. We have social planners everywhere. We decide fiscal policy with social planners, macroprudential policy with social planners, how to do monetary policy with social planners. Okay, so we're not the first, the macro people. There's a long tradition in public finance approach of benevolent governments. Now, benevolent means that the governments do the best for their constituencies, and they understand what is best. So, for example, the regional governments maximize local benefits, because they only look at their constituency. So they maximize, when they make decisions, they try to maximize the local benefits that their constituencies obtain. But the union government is wider. Some would even say wiser. And cares about everybody in the union. And as a result, it looks at local benefits plus externalities. So it has the right preferences. Somehow the regional governments, even though they are benevolent to their constituencies, they end up being selfish or having the wrong preferences. While the central government has the right preferences. In some of this literature, on top of that, they typically assume that somehow the central government or the union government is capable of exploiting economies of scale. But the union the regional governments, they cannot coordinate and exploit the economies of scale. The technology is out there, but they fail to coordinate, and they don't manage to get these economies of scale. Today, I'm not going to talk about this. I'm going to assume in the background that they can do this coordination, or economies of scale are not that important. Okay? But then, obviously, once you have set the stage in this way, you have a government that is a union government that has the right preferences, a regional government that has the wrong preferences, then obviously the answer is going to be centralize everything, give all the decisions to the central government. That obviously is a bit absurd, and this is why typically an assumption is added, which is somewhat ad hoc, which is a policy uniformity assumption that says the central government or the union government cannot tailor policies to local preferences. It has to make the same decision for everybody. This is the policy uniformity constraint associated with those, and that makes the central government or the union government, it makes it inefficient. The regional governments, two regional governments could decide one does a project and the other does a different project. So they can make decisions that are contingent on them. But instead, the union government has to decide the same thing for both. It cannot make it contingent, even if they want different things. You are with me? So typically, this traditional approach, the way to think the Simon problem is a choice between giving it to the regional governments that have the wrong preferences, or giving it to the union that has the right preference but is inefficient. You are with me? And all the policy prescriptions of this approach come from this notion. You can put bells and whistles, you then have to have a particular setup, and you have to make a discussion of details, how important are externalities and things, but the sort of things that come up, there are simple recipes for policy applications, which are assigned project types. By a project type, I would say, for example, education, okay? When we do a fiscal constitution, we don't say it has to be an incomplete contract. It has to say educational matters go to the regional government, and banking regulation goes to the union government. We don't say if a project of banking comes in this way and this other way and so on and so forth, then to here, another banking of this other way goes to the other one. We cannot do that, okay? So when I talk about project types, I'm going to be talking about broad themes. I'm going to be talking about education, pensions, health, things of that sort. So basically, the recipes that come from policy applications is that if there are large externalities in these project types, if typically most of the projects within this type have large externalities, they should go to the union, because having the wrong preferences is a bad thing. They should not go to the regions. And if instead the externalities are low, let them to the regions, because of course they have the wrong preferences, but they are more efficient. They will be able to do it better. Similar things that come up is that, for example, projects that generate disagreement, where, for example, the benefits are positive, but externalities are negative, so we have conflict. Or alternative, the local benefits are negative, but the externalities are positive. In this case that there is disagreement, it is better to put it to the union. It's better to send it to the central government, because it has the right preference. Because if not the regions, will do the wrong thing very efficiently, which is the worst thing that can happen. Okay? So in general, this type of results appear. There are very simple recipes. All these recipes come from these assumptions that I made here. For the last many years, there has been a bunch of people that have questioned this view. They have questioned this view. They have basically questioned the fact that governments are benevolent. And this is what one can call the political economy approach. Okay? There's a lot of papers. There's people that question that the government is benevolent because how is it that preference aggregation problem is solved? If all regions have different preferences and they value projects differently, how is it that somehow when we put them all together, let's say in a union parliament or in a central government, they end up doing the right thing? How come are we aggregating preferences well? And there are excellent papers in this boat by Lockwood, by Besley and Coate, by Harstad. These are three papers going this direction. There's another way, even if we could aggregate preferences, even if we did, how can we induce policymakers to maximize their preferences, not their own? That's the agency problem. How can we make, even if we understand exactly what is the good thing for policy, how can we make these policymakers maximize these preferences and not their own preferences, which are different from the general ones? And there's a bunch of papers by Besley and Kay, Seabright, Bardana Mukherjee, Besley and Smart, Bofa Piolato and Ponzetto that go through that. I've been reading this literature for the last year or so, or a half, and I find it fascinating. It's really fascinating. It's very insightful. And it's full of novel ideas, all of them capturing an aspect of reality. But I have to say as well that when I put them all together, there is no consensus that emerges from all of these. All of these point at different problems, different issues. There is no consensus that is coming either to confirm the previous view, the traditional view, or to replace it with something different. In fact, when you look at these papers, it's interesting. Some of the papers are trying to provide micro foundations for the old view. Say, well, perhaps the policy uniformity assumption comes endogenously once you do this and that. There are some other papers that do the opposite. The policy uniformity assumption doesn't work, and this is not the way, and they look for limits. And even there are papers that they do both. Sometimes they find micro foundations, sometimes they find limits to the old approach, but there is no simple recipes like the ones I was mentioning you before that come up with this approach. And today I'm going to try to help a little bit to distill or to understand a little bit what might come from this literature. So what I want to do today is to try to provide a very partial and very tentative answer to these questions. Can this modern approach provide simple and sharp recipes to guide policy applications? And I'm going to ask as well, how do they compare with those of the traditional view? Okay? And let me tell you what I'm going to do more precisely. I'm going to say that this is partial answers because I'm going to ignore this part of the literature. I'm going to ignore the agency problem. I'm going to assume that representatives always do the right thing. So I don't know what happens when we remove that assumption. But I'm going to focus on the preference aggregation. I'm going to assume that there is no benevolent social planner, but decisions are taken by parliaments. Most fiscal policy decisions are taken by parliaments through voting. Okay? So once I do that, I find that actually, in this type of models of preference aggregation, there is a very strong symmetry that somehow has gone unnoticed, or people have not focused so much when writing these papers. I'm going to take a paper, and I'm going to take a model that is very close to one that Ben Lockwood used in a Review of Economic Studies paper in 2002. And I'm going to look at this model, and I'll try to say, can I find recipes, simple recipes of who should make decisions? And I'm going to find that actually, once you remove the benevolent thing, there's a strong symmetry in the problem. Actually, I find that regional governments indeed maximize local benefits, but the union government doesn't have preferences that maximize the right thing. They maximize externalities. And you might say, well, is this a question of this particular model or not? Actually, it's extremely robust. It's extremely robust. Let me tell you the simple intuition and you will understand me. Imagine all of you are regions, okay? All of you are regions. And when a project is done, all of us are regions in a big union, okay? There's many more people here than in the European Union or Landers, but let's assume that's the case. If I have to decide a project in my region, I look at the local benefits. But for you, it's going to have externalities. You're with me? It's going to have some externalities that are positive. Who is the median voter in the regional parliament? The median voter in the regional parliament is a local guy. And the local guy has the preferences of the region. So he will or she will maximize, he or she will maximize local benefits. Now we go to the union, and I am just one of all these many. Who's going to be the median voter? The median voter will be somebody that is not the region itself. And this median voter will care about externalities. I will try to maximize externalities. If a project in my region causes a pain, we'll say no. If a project in my region causes a benefit to them, the externalities are positive, it's going to say yes. Actually, this is to get the intuition. With a simple median voter case, it's very clear. I'm not going to present a median voter. I'm going to present first a median voter case, But then I'm going to show you that this goes in full generality. I will have a model where there are many decisions, all the decisions are made at the same time, there's no medium-butter theorem that applies, and I will show you how difficult it is to go away from this medium-butter result. No matter what you do, it's very difficult to go away from it. You are with me? There is something embedded in these models of preference aggregation, regardless of the specific medium-butter theorem applies or not, that actually says local parliaments, or regional parliaments, maximize local benefits. Union parliaments maximize externalities. This logic is very strong. Once you realize this, I don't know where I left, yep, here. Once you realize this, the problem is extremely more symmetric. We have simply two parliaments that maximize different things. Both of them are the wrong things. So both of them have the wrong preferences. I do not assume a policy uniformity constraint. I'm not going to make the union government more inefficient. I'm going to assume that the union government, I will assume that the union government can tailor policies to local preferences if it wishes to. Perhaps it doesn't want to, but that's another matter. But I'm not going to constrain them to do that. Then when that happens, the Simon problem is a choice not between a guy with the right preferences and a guy with the wrong inefficient. But these two guys that have two different preferences, all of them are wrong, but they are wrong in their own special way. Okay, one looks at a piece of the project, which is externalities, and the other looks at another piece of the project, which is local benefits. And the question is to assign the decision to the particular government, that has the least damaging preferences. Okay, the one that is going to be less bad, to put it in a way. Okay? So for example, when you do that, and I'm going to show you some examples, what you realize is that you get simple recipes for policy applications, very simple. And these simple recipes, however, are quite different from the traditional view. In particular, you get results that says project types with large externalities relative to local benefits. That was forgotten before. In the previous one, local benefits were not important because both the union and the regional governments maximize them. What made them different is that one maximizes externalities and the other does not. Okay? So here what you're going to see is that now, even if externalities are huge, if local benefits are even higher, you keep it in the regional government. Even if externalities are very small, but local benefits are even smaller, you put it in the union government. Okay? That's the sort of thing. And the second thing that matters here, which didn't come true in the other one, is that disagreement, that only these statements have to be conditional on disagreement. If both externalities and local benefits are positive and we all agree, that's not an issue. What we have to care is in the instances in which we disagree. In the previous one was not true, because even if we did agree, the central government would do mistakes because it's forced by the policy uniformity constraint to do mistakes. But now if we agree and we don't have any constraint, we will do the right thing. So it could be a project that has huge externalities on instances in which we agree, but small externalities relative to local benefits in instances in which we disagree. Then we should put it in the regional government. Despite, even though it has super high externalities when we agree, and we agree 99% of the time, we still should send it to this. All these results are conditional on disagreement. I'll be much more specific. The rest of this talk will be to explain you all of this. Okay? So that's a little bit. I wanted to have like a little bit longer introduction, so in case I get to technicalities and some of you decide not to pay that much attention, you know what the message is. Okay? Good. So what I'm going to do now is to tell you a little bit about the plan. I'm going to first tell you about the model. So it's going to be very quick. It's a simple model, and you will see how it works in a minute. Then I'm going to derive a first result under a strategic assumption that delivers the medium butter. And that allows me to get the result in two steps. Very simple. After that, I'm going to derive this result and show you what it means and so on and so forth. And then I will say, let me take away this strategic assumption. Let me show you now what happens when we vote, what happens when we do that. And that's what I'm going to talk here. And then I'm going to talk about two extensions very briefly, these two very briefly, and I'll say some concluding remarks. That's the plan of the presentation. Let me tell you a little bit about the model. So the model has the following elements. There are n regions, okay? So there's going to be a certain amount of regions, 1 over n. I'm going to be assuming throughout that n is very large. I'm going to assume that there are different project types. As I said, project types, 1 to I. The project types, you can think of them as educational decisions on education, decisions on health, decisions on pensions, decisions on infrastructure, on banking regulation, on taxation, on different matters. Each of them is one of these project types. I'm going to assume that each region, I'm going to make the regions symmetric. I'll say at the end some issues about heterogeneity, which is, I think it's it opens a complete new door to complications and interesting issues, but I'm not going to deal with them today. So I'm going to talk about each region has 1 over n of the population and has 1 project of each type, okay? To simplify matters, there is 1 project of each type, 1 project of education, 1 project of whatever, okay? 1 project I, what is this? I lost, okay, here it is. 1 project provides local benefits to the region beta IN. Beta IN are the benefits that the region gets. And this project will give externalities epsilon IN to the other regions. When you add over the N minus 1 regions, epsilon IN is the total amount of externalities that it creates. Okay? And I'm going to think that those local benefits and externalities are measured in monetary terms. So I can add them. Okay? So this is beta I is in millions of dollars or euros. This epsilon IN is also in millions of euros. Okay? Now, ex ante, all type of projects are identical. So every region will have 1 of these projects, and before uncertainty is realized, we don't know whether this is going to be a fantastic project that has a huge beta and a huge epsilon, that's a fantastic project, or we don't know whether it's going to be an awful project, beta negative and epsilon negative, which is awful and we don't want to do it. Okay? So this Every type is a distribution. And for examples, I will use bivariate normals. I will use normal distributions in my examples. I will use bivariate normals. Ex post, the quality of I projects differs across regions because ex ante, when we talk about educational projects, they are all ex ante identical. But then each of us takes a draw from that distribution. You get a great project, you get a great project, you get a less good project, you get an awful project, and you too, and so on and so on. Sorry, eh? but that's what you get, okay? And as a result, this is important because when we decide on a constitution and we decide on the assignment rule, we know this, but we don't know this. That's going to be crucial. We're going to know this part, we're going to know the type of projects that they are, on average how they look like, but we don't know specific projects. We know infrastructure, but we're not going to know whether this particular bridge will have positive or negative externalities to the other regions. Okay? Now, this is the project space. And you're going to be seeing this picture lots of time, not this particular one, but the project space. You're going to see the project space. So every project is going to be a point in this project space. For example, These projects in A are going to be projects that are really nice. They have positive local benefits and positive externalities. Everybody loves these projects. You are with me? So there's no disagreement here. Okay? And obviously, the farther away in this direction we go, the better the project is. It has more externalities and more local benefits. Now, if you take a look at these projects here, these are projects that lead to conflict or disagreement. They have positive local benefits. That's great. The region is all for them. But actually, they have negative externalities to the rest of the union. So the union is unhappy about these particular projects. You're with me? So typically, we're going to have this quadrant here. We're going to be great. Here, we're going to be discarding those. This way, everybody wants to implement. This everybody wants to discard. And here, we're going to get some disagreement. Good? I'm going to use throughout. OK, this is the same space. You're going to see it sometimes in this way. This is the externalities. The local benefits. And here are the externalities. For example, in this case, I assume that is a standard bivariate normal. So exposed, or ex ante, the distribution is this one. It's centered at zero, and it has mass symmetric around 0, 0. You are with me? In general, I'm going to make the assumption that n is large. And by making the assumption that n is large, I'm going to buy two things that are going to make the analysis really simple and nice. I don't know if elegant, but simple and nice, at least. The first one is that the share of projects, these are the projects that is in this particular region here, the ex ante probability will tell me the share of projects that are there. So I can use the ex ante probability that a project be there to say ex post, this is exactly the number of projects that are in that particular region. And I'm going to be saying things like region N is in AA. And you say, what do you mean region N is in AA? It means that the project of type I of region N is in AA. Okay, so this is where the project is located. Is it a good project or a bad project or so on? Also, whenever I want to know how much value is there in a particular area, how much value do these projects have, I can use the ex ante. I can use the expected value of the project, which is the sum of local benefits plus externalities. This is the value or the expected value of the project conditional on being in that area, times the number of projects in that area. So this is the value of the projects there. And I'm going to use large N approximations to see that exposed, the number of projects in that area and the value of projects in that area is given by the ex ante distribution. Good? That's an approximation I do. Okay? Now we have. We're going to have N regional parliaments. We're going to have N regional parliaments and a union parliament. And they will make the decisions knowing the realization of the projects. So when they make the decisions, they look at the project space and they know exactly how many local benefits are there and how many externalities are there. So basically, that means that once we have decided to say, let's say, for instance, to put banking regulation in the union government, then there's going to come a particular project on banking regulation. And the union will study that, will make decisions, knowing very well how this project looks like. Okay, we'll have had done research, we'll have debate, and so on and so forth, and we'll decide knowing exactly what the draw that has been. But ex ante, the assignment problem ex ante, we have to assign the banking regulation to either the regional or the local or the regional government, the regional or the union government. And that we don't know how the projects are going to be exposed. And that's why when we do the assignment, we're going to choose either the region or the union in a way that maximizes value ex ante. In this model here, up to this point, that everybody is identical, there's going to be no conflict here. Everybody ex ante wants to send it to the place that gives the higher value. If the higher value is if you assign it to the region, assign it to the region. If the higher value is to assign it to the union, assign it to the union. Okay? So there is no conflict because everybody is identical. I'll come back to that at the end. Okay, so fiscal constitutions are incomplete contract and no conflict on fiscal constitution. So now, let me just say one thing more. Okay, so let me just say. Now we can go after here and now I'm going to solve the model. What is the right assignment? What decisions do they make? You have already all the assumptions. First thing I want you to know, this set here is the set of socially efficient projects. These are projects that the sum of benefits and externalities is positive. So somebody with the right preferences, if somehow there were somebody that a dictator with the right preferences, here neither the Union Parliament nor the Regional Parliament will have the right preferences, as I will show you in a second. But if somebody existed and were a dictator with the right preferences, would say, implement everything that is in the green line, in the green area, and discard any project that is in this area. This is the objective. If we did this, that would be, if we can find a political structure, a social choice mechanism that does that, that would be wonderful. Okay? Because here we are maximizing economic efficiency. If a project has non-negative value, implement it. If a project has negative value, discard it. It's as simple as that. Unfortunately, this is not what people are going to do. Why they are not going to do this way? Let me show you. Let me stop. Let me go through that. Let me just say that, for starters, these social preferences, which are the ones described here, the maximized value, economic efficiency, are not shared by any region in the place. There's not a single region in this world that has these preferences. If you took a particular region, you or myself, and were given the chance to be a dictator and decide for everyone, what would that region do? Well, that region would say, if my own project has positive externalities, local benefits, I implement it. And what about the projects of the others? Well, the projects of the others, implement them only if they have positive externalities to me. You're with me? And if either this is negative or the others have negative externalities, discard. So the set of projects that would implement is not the same as the social value. For its own projects, it would maximize local benefits. For the projects of others, it would maximize externalities. That's what each region does. In the Union Parliament, we're going to throw representatives of all the regions, and we'll see what happens. You are with me? So that's the issue. Okay, so now let me do the first solution, as I was mentioning. The first solution, I'm going to make a strategic assumption, I told you. Because if we are in a parliament, and we can think of this as a parliament, with every representatives of all the regions, each of you representing one particular region, and we have to vote for projects. Principally, we would put bills that incorporate many, many projects, and then we will vote for the whole bill or not, okay? And that's complicated, because there's gonna be, it's a decision that is multidimensional. There are many, many, many projects at the same time, and typical simple models don't give us a good solution for that. I've worked and I got a solution, and I'll tell you later. But for the time being, let us assume that we vote project by project. So first we go and we take your project, and we make a vote among all of us. Do we implement or not Eliana's project? Then my project, do we implement or not Jaume's project? And each of them is voted separately. You are with me? Let me do that strategic assumption. That strategic assumption I'll remove, but it's very useful. Because once we do that, now the medium voter applies. Because why? Because we have a single, the policy has only one dimension. There are two values, either one implement, zero discard. And as a result, preferences are single picked, and the median voter theorem applies. And the key question of the Simon problem, is which median voter decides, the median voter of the regional parliament or the median voter of the union parliament? Let's assume that we assign these particular projects to the regional parliament. What will the regional parliament do? Well, it will implement everything that has positive local benefits. And it will discard everything that has negative local benefits. This is the set of projects that will be implemented by the regional parliament. Okay, that's clear, no? If it has negative local benefits, I don't want it. If it has positive local benefits, I want it and I implement it. It's as simple as that. But now let's go to the Union Parliament. In the Union Parliament, you have the median voter.
The median voter of the Union Parliament is not the region, it's somebody else that looks only at externalities. And then as a result, the rule will be that the Union Parliament is going to implement everything that has positive externalities. So if externalities are positive, do it. If externalities are negative, discard it. You're with me? So now we can see this is the set of the projects that are implemented if you assign them to the region. And this is the set of projects that are implemented if you assign it to the Union Parliament. And now I want to think about which one is best. What do I do? And obviously the answer depends on where the mistakes are and what the mass of projects is. You're with me? So let me show you the disagreement set. The disagreement set is the projects on which there will be a disagreement. And this disagreement set here is going to play an important role. It's these two quadrants here. Here there is disagreement because the region will implement, but the union won't. Here there is disagreement because the union will implement, but the region won't. Here everybody agrees to implement, and here everybody agrees to discard. You're with me? So one of the interesting aspects here is that if these two, the Union Parliament and the Regional Parliament, are different and they lead to different type of losses, you're already going to see that only we have to compare what happens here. What happens here and here, it doesn't matter because they both do the same. You're with me? Any simple recipe that comes up through is going to have to be conditional on this agreement. Good? Let's move on. These here are the mistakes that the regional parliaments make. Remember, the yellow one is exactly what the regional parliaments say, yes, implement, and here the regional parliament says, no, implement. And they do two types of sins, by omission and by commission, you see? These ones here are projects that it is implementing, but that they are not socially efficient. Remember that the socially efficient where this negative 45 degree line. So these ones here are socially efficient and they implement, that's great. But these ones here, they are not. They are implementing them and they shouldn't. The externalities, the negative externalities, outweigh the positive benefits. And these ones here, they are not doing and they are good. They have some local, negative local benefits, but huge positive externalities to the rest. You're with me? So these are the mistakes that this does, and these obviously are the mistakes that the union does. Once again, the union is not implementing these ones here that are good, and it's implementing these ones here that are bad, because they deliver positive externalities, even if because the local benefits are low. You're with me? So now you can just look at them. They feel the disagreement. What is interesting in this simple model, that's not true as I complicate the story, and I will complicate the story a little bit, is that we never agree to do the wrong thing, you see? Here, either we disagree or we do the right thing. But you will see later on cases in which both the union and the region parliament do the wrong thing. And there's no way to get the right thing done on that particular region. That can happen. And if there's no way to get the right thing done, then it doesn't matter for the assignment. Because no matter where you send it, they're going to do the wrong call. You're with me? The only thing that will matter for assignment is always a disagreement set. It's the only part that matters. But don't think that it's always so nice that when we agree on the right thing. Many times, the two parliaments will agree on the wrong thing, too. Okay? Later on. So these are the two sets. Okay? And if you take these two sets, you're going to see the other part of the recipe. The first part of the recipe, I told you, it's conditional on the disagreement. I'll say that formally in a statement, but it's easier to talk through the pictures. But I'll tell you in a second in a proposition. But the first thing is that the only thing that matters is disagreement. And then what happens within disagreement? Look at the blue case here and the blue case here. What do they have in common, this triangle and this triangle? Well, this triangle here, local benefits, and local benefits in absolute value are larger than externalities in absolute value. You're with me? So here, for example, is 3, 1 in absolute value. And here is 1, 3 also in absolute value. Okay? So the union makes mistakes when local benefits in absolute value are large relative to externalities in absolute value within the disagreement set, conditional on disagreeing. Because here, also, the local benefits are large in absolute value than this, but we don't care about those. Okay? This is all you have to look in this sort of world. Now, the same thing. Here is where the region is making mistakes. The region is making mistakes where local benefits in absolute value are smaller than externalities in absolute value. You see that what matters, for example, let me just tell you, okay, this is the proposition that tells you what I'm going to tell you. Okay, this is a proposition that tells you that that if there are n regional parliaments from one union parliament, well, it depends on this. Okay, let me go directly to here. A statement such as we should assign projects with a small externality to the region and projects with large externality to the union are not correct if you adopt this view. This is the traditional view, but this is not correct here. It is not the size of externalities, it's the absolute size. A statement such as we should assign to the union projects with large externalities and small local benefits are better, but still not correct. It should be conditional on this agreement. You are with me? And let me show you some examples. Okay? Let me tell you an example here. Let me tell you what I'm doing. Okay? So this example here, I take a distribution that is centered, the same. This is the distribution, and then I'm going to do the following. I'm going to look at cases as we move. I'm going to center the distribution here, and I'm going to move it in this direction and in this direction. Okay? Since I am moving it in this direction and in this direction, that doesn't change the relative size of externalities and its local benefits is the same. Sorry, here what I have are the costs of the mistakes that are made by the regional government, the union government. The proposition told you, for a given project type, assign it to the parliament that will have less costly mistakes. And I calculate those mistakes. And you can see that when we are at 0-0, here, when we are at 0-0, we have some mistakes. But as we move here, we enter into disagreement territory. And when we enter into disagreement territory, mistakes increase by both. And that's what this tells you. But both the same. It doesn't matter. Externalities can be huge, but it doesn't matter. You don't want to change the assignment. Are the same for everybody. Here is another case in which now I move in the other direction. So I move in this direction. Now I move here. I move in this direction, also through the 45-degree line. You can see that the costs now are becoming smaller as we enter into agreement territory. Okay, this is the sort of, this is this one, the distribution here. This one is the distribution here. This one is the distribution here. And for each distribution, we have plotted this. Okay? This is another example. Now, what I do here now is to change the variance of beta relative to the variance of epsilon. So here, it's all round and nice. But here, basically, we are aligned like this. A lot of mass here. And if there is a lot of mass here, the union is very bad. If there is a lot of mass here, the region is very bad. And that's what you observe. Now, as you move the mass laterally, the most important thing are externalities, the losses of the region are very high. And the losses of the union are very small. You should send it to the union. But as you change, and you move the other way around, there's a lot of local benefits, you're going to get it to the losses of the parliament, the union parliament go up, and the losses of the union go down, the region go down. Yeah? That's another case in which I change the correlation. Now I make the correlation negative. We are in territory of disagreement, so both of them have a lot of costs. Now I make it positive. We are in agreement, and the costs are low. But the costs are the same, because in all of them, I have assumed that the mean is the same. Relative size of the two. Okay? This is basically the sort of thing that happens. Now I want to compare these results to the traditional case. So for example, imagine that I assume that there are n unconstrained regional planners that maximize the value for the region. And there is one union planner that maximizes value for the union. So the union planner has the right thing, but it has the policy uniformity constraint that either implements our projects or none. You are with me? And we can repeat the exercises. In this particular case, the cost of the policy uniformity decision is that if you say, I'm going to do all of them, then I'm taking all these negative values in. Or if I say, do nothing, then I lose all positive values here. You are with me? So now I'm going to look at this. The value of the region, the union is going down and up, and this social planner is not changing in this example. Let me give you another one. This is very interesting, for instance. This one, again, is the one where we were moving up. The benefits are going and going down. You see that there is no reason to assign to any particular place if you take the approach of the political economy approach or the symmetry approach. But instead, if you look at the traditional case, the union government makes a lot of mistakes. If it is a social planner, the union social planner makes a lot of mistakes if this is in the middle. Because if it is in the middle, the value is divided between the two sides, and the policy uniformity constraint is terrible because I lose half of the value, basically. But if instead I put the value, I move into the agreement region or the disagreement region, it goes down. So here, for example, it would tell you in applications that if you are in this region, you should send it to the region. If you are in this region, you send it to the region. Here you should send it to the region. Here you should send it to the union. Here you should send it to the union. But then this approach says, no, it's just the same. It's irrelevant. You're with me? Well, I'm not going to punish you through all the examples, but you can see there's a discrepancy. I've constructed a bunch of examples that show that the rules of assignment these are quite different or can become quite different if you think of the problem of the assignment as an inefficient central government against with the right preferences against an efficient regional government with the wrong preferences, that if instead you think, no, why are they differently efficient? They are equally efficient, but they both have wrong preferences. They look for different things. They have the preferences that are wrong, but in a symmetric way. Let me just tell you that there is another approach that I will not discuss today, which is the cohesion approach, that asks even the social planner approach basically is one approach, but another approach says we don't need a union government because it's always possible to bargain or it's always possible it's always possible that the regions can sit together, decide on the optimal policy and so on and so forth. I mean, there is a nice paper by Bart sitting there that shows that this is not possible even in the two-region case, but it's going to be much more difficult in an n-region case, because in an n-region case, if we have to buy a region the right to make a decision and the other n minus one regions have to get together and agree on that, this is going to be hard, very difficult. It's a typical collective action problem that we don't have a good solution for. What I want to do in the last few minutes is to show you a little bit of the heavy lifting. Okay, I've been trying to say the easy message, the most of this, but I'm going to, for those of you that might be more interested in the details, I'm going to now remove the assumption that we are voting project by project. And I'm going to look at what are the equilibrium bills that will be voted in this parliament. And I'm going to tell you the results and have a little bit of a comment. The proofs are a little bit involved. So we're going to do it this way. If you vote for my project, I will vote for yours. Can this bargain soften the externality maximizing logic of the Union Parliament and make it sensitive to local benefits? Could it be that I'm voting bill by bill? We don't allow the Parliament to be a market for policies. Perhaps a few of you, a few regions, sit together and say, look, vote for my project, I vote for yours, and we put a bill together that does that, and that's going to be the equilibrium outcome, and the union parliament will end up being sensitive to local benefits. You are with me? Okay, I define a bill as a set of projects that are implemented. I define the coalition. B1I, B2Y is the coalition or share of regions that prefers to vote the first bill, B1, in a pairwise vote against B2. Okay, so this is the number of people that if you put the two of them in a pairwise vote, that will support the first one, the B1. I define a bill B1 as a Condorcet winner as usual if it beats any other bill in a pairwise vote. If there is a bill that I can find that beats any other potential bill, is a Condorcet winner, and that's, we know it's gonna be the solution. Typically, it's not gonna happen, but it might happen. For example, one bill would be that I'm gonna play is the BE. This is the bill that implements externality maximization. This is this bill. It implements all the projects here. Okay? Another bill that is interesting is the BS, that maximizes values. A bill that says, let's implement these projects, but not these ones. You are with me? Now the question, the first question is, this is the bill that we know that will occur with voting, project by project voting. And we want to understand, is this bill beatable? Can we beat this bill once we allow it to fight against any other conceivable bill? Okay? And I get some of these results. Okay? I don't know if I'm going to go through that. Let me not do the proof. Let me just tell you, state the results. Okay? Let me tell you this. Let BE be the set of bills that would beat externality maximization. So it's a set of bills that would beat externality maximization. Good? These sort of bills that will beat, if this BE is empty, so that means that externality maximization is a Condorcet winner, then majority voting goes through. Majority voting goes through. Majority voting generates externality maximization. This one is the winner. And then all the previous analysis that I made remains intact, despite the fact that now I allow all types of bills. Okay, I allow coalitions to be formed, propose a bill, and so on. If it beats everyone, it's going to be the same as before. Is this very difficult to do? Well, let me just show you this, not because I want to show you this. Let me just show you something. If half of the mass is in the agreement side, then there's no way to beat that bill. Because there's going to be half of the regions, at least, that are super happy with externality maximization. Externality maximization gives them the local benefits they want. And it maximizes the externalities from others. So a first result is that if these two quadrants have half of the mass, the bill that implements externality maximization is going to be the outcome of this game. So in order to have to beat externality maximization, there has to be a lot of mass, or at least more than half of the mass, in the disagreement regions. Otherwise, I can allow any legislative bargaining situation, unless it's rigged to give you what you want or something like this, but I can give you any standard model of legislative bargaining or not even make assumptions about it, and externality maximization wins. Now let's see what happens if a lot of mass is here and there are some bills that can beat it. Let me take you a look. If this is not empty, I find that the Union Parliament then exhibits Condorcet cycles. There is no outcome. Then what we find in that situation, and I'm not going to prove it now, but I'll be delighted to talk about the proof with any one of you that wants afterwards. Basically, what we find is that there's always a bill that beats the externality maximizing, but then externality maximizing beats another bill, and that other bill beats the original bill. You are with me? So we get this, it's not transitive. The preferences are not transitive, and there's no solution. What this means is that in this case, we have to put more structure on the voting process. We have to start thinking about agendas, how agendas are formed, or things like that. I took a very simple model that is due to Ferejon, Fiorina, McKelvey, and actually as implemented by Lockwood in his 2002 paper. This is one in which there are two stages of the game. First, representative propose bills. All the bills, the agenda includes all the bills. And if at the end, these bills, and at the end of it, there is this bill, because if we don't reach an agreement, then we vote bill by bill, project by project. And then in the second step, they sequentially. The ordering is random, and then do this. If you look at that, this bill is the one that wins the context, the one that wins all these sequences of pairings. If you look at that, I get this result. The bill that maximizes the bill, let's be the bill that maximizes externalities within the sets that beat the maximum externality maximization. So there's a bill that implements externality maximization. And then there is a set of bills that beat it. So the among these that beat it, this bill is the one that maximizes externalities. It's not maximizes like the other, but it maximizes within that set. Then if B is empty, this is the solution. If B is not empty, this is this. So basically what we find is that if externality maximizing can be beaten, it will be beaten. I created the rules to beat externality maximization. But it is then beaten by the closest bill that can beat it, the one that is closer to it, the one among those that can beat it, the one that has the maximum externalities. How often this happens? How different are these two? That's what I'm going to do. Basically, what I find is that, and I do that in I find that good bargains, bills that beat it and actually raise efficiency, can only occur when the Union Parliament is worse than coin tossing as a social choice mechanism. The Union Parliament has to do more than 50% of mistakes in order to beat externality maximization. But if the Union Parliament makes more than 50% of mistakes, we better make decisions by tossing a coin. You see? This is the sort of results that come. I only have 1 minute, or less than 1 minute. So what I want to do is that to say, that basically, sometimes the bargains that come out actually reduce efficiency. And in all the examples I have looked, it is always better to send it to the regional parliament. So I'm going to conclude with two observations. First, I'm going to say that if the projects have costs, that doesn't change anything. Second, I'm going to say that if externalities are distributed unevenly across other, across all the regions, that changes nothing too. These are just things that I did to present it in a simpler way. And I want to conclude basically by telling you the message what I said today, and that's going to be the conclusion. First, the traditional public finance approach produces simple recipes based on the idea that regions have the wrong preferences, but the union is subject to the policy uniformity constraint. I show today that actually the new or modern political economy approach also has simple recipes. Once you assume that both have the wrong preferences, but not assume you derive, both have the wrong preferences a different way. These recipes are very different. They treat externalities, local benefits, and conflict in a quite different way. There are many issues on the agenda, heterogeneity and conflict, economic efficiency, other social criteria, selection of candidates and projects, agency problems, you name them. And I thank you very much for your attention.